Danny Quaranto. I'm an acupuncturist. I've been an acupuncturist for about 28 years now. So we're going to talk to you about balancing hormones today. And I'm going to give it to you from a little bit different perspective maybe, but I think you'll see that what I'm saying is going to make sense. Why is this guy up here standing here and talking mostly about female hormones? I know we have hormones too, but you know, the other hormones aren't placed, and we're not very happy either, I think. So I'm an expert on female hormones because of these two lovely children and their wife. Let me bring this up for you. Things I want to dispel some myths maybe about hormones and especially menopause. Menopause can't be because somebody has a lack of estrogen. Does that make sense? No, it doesn't make sense, does it? Okay. If it was not true, then women 10-15 years down the road would be worse, and not worse, but better. So it can't be from a lack of estrogen. So the reason that we have these menopausal symptoms, and look at the menopausal symptoms. What are we looking at a lot of times? We're looking at naturally the hot flashes and night sweats, okay, mental fogginess, aches and pains. Okay, all of those things are not hormonally driven. Mental fogginess doesn't have a lot to do with hormones.
Depression?
Yeah, depression, yeah. Throw that in there, sure. So there's some of these symptoms that people have in menopause, and then men will call it andropause, as we call it andropause, when guys start getting symptoms and when they get older too, that have a hormonal component to it, and there are other symptoms that have a neurological component to them, and there's other symptoms that have an immune system component to them. So your immune system gets fired up and causes inflammation and causes aches and pains and all kinds of symptoms that you would get if you had inflammation. Arthritis. The mental, emotional symptoms are going to be your central nervous system being affected. So I want to give you a picture that kind of brings all of that into focus. Do I click that many things already off? I don't want to get trigger happy. So, all right, here's the signal. That's your brain. Mm-hmm. Not your brain?
Mm-hmm.
This is everybody's brain. Now, your brain's going to be broken into different parts. These here are neurons, okay? And these point, all the rest of them over here are glial cells. So I drew it like that because that's kind of the way it is. For every one neuron, you have 10 glial cells, okay? When we're talking about brain, these are the guys we're talking about. Neurons help you to do things like think and calculate and talk and speak and feel and touch and taste and smell and move the nervous system, right? That's what the neurons do. These guys over here, which a lot of people don't really think about, these are immune cells. So your brain is actually one part neurons and the other 10 parts are immune cells. So you have this intimate connection here between your immune system and your nervous system. So here's how we bring it all home. All these neurons here have hormone receptor sites. A woman's brain, in the front part of the brain, they have a lot of receptor sites. When I say receptocytes, you guys clear on what I'm talking about when I say a receptocyte? You know, every cell in our system. Okay. Be creative here. Every cell in our system has all of these little receptocytes on there. The only thing that's really important for us and what determines our function is what gets inside of this cell. There's the blood out here, and you certainly got everything in your blood, right? You got your glucose, you got your hormones, you got your vitamins, you got your minerals, you got everything. Everything's in the blood. What's in the blood isn't as important as what gets into the cell over here. So you got a glucose receptor site here that says, okay, the cell says, hey, I need some sugar, I need some fuel, give me some fuel. So what it does is it makes this receptor site more sensitive to glucose. So the glucose that's in your blood now is going to be attracted to this receptor site and it's going to get transferred inside your cell. That's where all the action takes place, is in the cell, not inside the blood, okay? So the receptor sites for a woman in the front part of the brain are mainly estrogen receptor sites. And for guys, the front part of the brain is mostly testosterone receptor sites. We think differently, yeah. The front part of your brain, is a part of your brain that helps you with cognition and, you know, calculating things. It's also responsible for your appropriate social reactions. So anybody ever hear of a woman that took all her clothes off in menopause and started running down the street? Well, it happens.
People, and guys
too. You know, so this part of their brain isn't functioning that well. You know, your socially
frontal cortex.
Yeah, that's part of the brain that determines your social appropriateness. And so, a guy climbs to the top of the mountain and takes his clothes off. Okay, so whatever. It's inappropriate reaction is that frontal cortex part of the brain that's being affected. And you have receptor sites for testosterone for guys mostly here, and estrogen receptor sites that takes the estrogen in. So, so you can have hormonal imbalances that affect your, you know, social actions out there too, right? So the neurons have these hormone receptor sites. The glial cells, these are immune cells. The immune cells also have hormone receptor sites. One of the major reasons why people have menopausal symptoms is not because of the lack of estrogen, but it's a sudden drop of estrogen that causes us to fire up the immune system, and it produces all kinds of inflammatory substances. One of the big ones is it's called interleukin-6. I'm putting these things down because some of you guys are writing, you want to go and research it, you want to PubMed and look this stuff up. The sudden drop of estrogen produces a large amount of this interleukin-6 from your immune cells that are very inflammatory and will cause you. And that's been shown to cause osteoporosis and arthritis and heart disease. So isn't that another one of the symptoms that comes along in menopause too, right? Cardiovascular symptoms, right? Okay. So here we are with this intimate connection now between your hormonal system and your nervous system. If something's going wrong with your immune your hormonal system, it's going to affect your nervous system. It's also going to affect your immune system. If you've got a problem with your immune system that's overfiring or underfiring, it's going to affect your hormonal system. It's also going to affect your nervous system. If your nervous system isn't working properly, maybe you had a traumatic accident, a brain injury. Okay, that brain injury can fire up your immune system, and it affects the hormones too. You get the idea that this is all one thing; it's all connected. If one thing is affected, everything else is going to be affected. And what will drive any one of these guys nuts? And remember, if one of them is nuts, it's going to affect the other ones. What will drive any one of them nuts all by itself is blood sugar imbalances. You got blood sugar that's too low, it's going to affect your brain. It's going to affect the hormones, it's going to affect the immune system, it's going to affect the nervous system. Or you have diabetes or insulin resistance. Insulin resistance is this glucose receptor site here shut down. So now the cell isn't getting its glucose. So that's going to affect that blood sugar imbalance. It's going to affect the activity inside of the cell, every cell in the body. So blood sugar imbalances are a big deal. Interestingly, people that are insulin resistant, another name for insulin resistance is pre-diabetes or syndrome X or metabolic syndrome. They're all names for the same thing. We call it pre-diabetes just to really kind of focus it on kind of what it is. Just before you get diabetes, you'll be in an insulin resistant state. A woman that's in insulin resistance is going to have a tendency to start converting her estrogens into testosterone. Not a pretty sight to the beard, right?
What are the symptoms?
You'll wear the pants in the pants.
Literally? You grow hair?
You will. Yeah, you grow hair. Yeah, you grow hair. Your voice can deepen. You get more male characteristics. But that's, in a woman, estrogen is protective for the cardiovascular system. In a man, testosterone is protective for the cardiovascular system. So it's not any one of these hormones is bad or good. It's where are they in the balance of each other. For instance, we know that estrogen is proliferative for breast cancer. We also know that estrogen is proliferative for uterine cancer. What protects the breast is testosterone. What protects the uterus is progesterone. So you need to, you have a balance of these hormones. And where it can get thrown off sometimes is creams. Sometimes people use these topical creams to, hormone creams. Okay, well, if you're a guy and you're using testosterone cream, you gotta make sure you're not going to be hugging your honey, rubbing and having her get a bunch of testosterone. If you're a woman and you're using vaginal creams, the estrogen creams, you can't have sex with your guy while you're having the cream there. Okay, you look funny with boobs. and to follow this insulin resistance model a little bit further, if it's a guy, guy has insulin resistance, he'll start to convert his testosterone into estrogen. It's called aromatizing. You aromatize your testosterone into estrogen. Not a good thing. So let's let's look at a healthy progression through menopause, okay? So here's the ovaries, and the ovaries are starting to decrease the production of estrogen in the system. And this is a normal, healthy progression. This is the way it's supposed to be. And it's been, menopause has been medicalized. In other words, there are drugs now that you can take and codes that you can get codes for menopausal symptoms and have a drug for that. And some of the medications are kind of manufactured. They took the same drugs that they used before and they changed the name of it and just gave it to somebody that has menopausal symptoms. Seraphim used to be, it is, Prozac. The same thing as Prozac. So how is Seraphim helping menopausal, when I say menopausal, hormonal symptoms? Okay, it's got nothing to do with it. Prozac doesn't have anything to do with the affecting the hormonal system. It's just going to make you kind of chill out a little bit so you can be more livable, right?
It's more just like a drug to calm you down.
Prozac is a Prozac is an antidepressant. Yeah. So this is the nice steady progression through menopause that we should be getting. And menopause should be, and it's like this because as menopause, as the production of estrogen decreases, you have this compensating mechanism that comes in, kicks in, let's say right about here. Okay? Right around here, what happens here is your adrenal glands, around this point here, you start decreasing estrogen production, you hit this point here, your adrenal glands kick in, and they make this hormone here called this stuff converts into estrogen, that's androstenedione. So you're coming along here, you're decreasing the amount of estrogen you got, your adrenal glands kick in, make androstenedione. Androstenedione converts into estrogen, and you continue your way merrily along, everything's beautiful. That's the way it's supposed to be, you know. And gee, I started missing my periods, and my periods are gone now. I don't know why people make such a big thing out of this menopause thing. It was no big deal. That's the way it's supposed to be, right? Not, I'm going to kill somebody, right? So what happens in a pathological perspective is that people hit this point here and the decrease in the production of estrogen. The adrenal glands are worn down because you've been dealing with stresses over a prolonged period of time. You've got a husband that's a jerk. You've got a boss that's a jerk. You've got kids that are screwing up in your life. You've got the tax man coming to get you. You've got stresses on your life, right? And so you hit this point here because these guys are worn down. They don't produce enough of this that converts into estrogen. That's when you fall off the table. That's when the menopausal symptoms kick in. That's one of the models that happens with menopause. Even surgically, let's say you got to this point here, and your adrenal glands are really in pretty good shape, but you had fibroids or something, or cancer, and you had to have your ovaries removed. You're going to have this drop right here, but if these guys are healthy, you should pick up again and continue along like that. Remember, it's the sudden drop of estrogen that causes us to have the nervous system and the immune system start kicking in and firing inflammatory substances.
Okay. Dr. Q, can you replenish the estrogen like through foods?
Through foods.
Would we want to?
Yeah. If you're suffering, then you do what you need to do to make yourself comfortable. I'm not going to say don't do this or don't do that.
But if you're not suffering, you're not.
Yeah, if you're not suffering, then just keep on going. Yeah. If you're suffering, you do what you have to do to make yourself comfortable. But having said that, if you just have to keep on doing something all the time, even taking hormone replacement therapy or pharmaceuticals or Chinese herbs, if you have to keep on taking something all the time, it's not really addressing the deeper underlying reason why you're having the symptoms that you're having. So certainly if you're going to be thinking about hormone replacement, it would make sense that if you're going to do that, to do the more bioidentical hormones. That makes sense?
Right.
Right. What are they? Estrogen? There's three different types of estrogen. There's testosterone.
Like the pill, you mean?
Yeah, there's pills, there's creams, there's different things that you can take. But having said that, if you're having symptoms because you don't have enough estrogen in your system, then you need to find out why that's happening. Not just take, okay, you do a blood test and yep, you gotta have a little estrogen here, you need to take estrogen for it. You need to find out why you're having those symptoms. And most of the time it happens because I have a beautiful chart in here that I can show you, and it doesn't come up again until later, so let me wait till I get to that chart, because I can show it to you a little bit more visually. Okay. So if you're gonna take hormones, and you wanna use the more bioidentical ones first. So Premarin, if you're taking Premarin, which is one of the most popular ones. Anybody know what Premarin is, what it stands for, what it means? It's pregnant.
Mares.
Mares. Urine. Plus estrogen.
That's where it comes from.
Yeah, that's where it comes from. Well, they synthesize these things, and they don't act in your system the same way that the bioidentical ones are going to act. So let's look at some of these things here. Naturally, there's a wonderful book out, I used to have it here, somebody walked off with it.
Oh.
It was called The Menopause Industry, and it's exactly about what I was talking about before, how the medical industry has medicalized menopause and made syndromes that can be treated by drugs.
But it's actually just a natural phenomena that women go through.
Yeah. Is that something that's kind of strange for you to realize?
Yeah, I think it is for the whole society, because I've heard women say, you know, you should really get on the pill right away, because it'll make you feel better. I've never felt bad.
Right.
So I refuse to do any of that.
Sure, that's the way it's supposed to be. If they were feeling something that, other than feeling good, they needed to take something to make themselves feel good, okay, that's okay. But you gotta look for why I need to take this pill. And we'll address some of those things. Yeah.
It is so universal. I think God designed it by on purpose, because that's the stage, really, where a woman will redefine herself. She's wiring herself for wisdom, going forward stronger if she can, if she has that choice, if she understands what's happening. And it could be really a beautiful time. Some relationships will have to go.
I love menopause.
Yeah.
Right.
It's a wonderful time. To worry about getting pregnant anymore.
Safe date, yes.
Yeah. But the engineering, I don't know, God kind of screwed up on the engineering a couple of places. You know, he made men with a brain and a penis and only enough blood to run one at a time. That happened, you know, because when you get an erection, you send a lot of blood that way, right?
Yes. Yeah.
So your brain kind of suffers.
What was the name of that book that you were talking about that disappeared?
Oh, it's called The Menopause Industry. You can probably get it on Amazon.
Okay.
You get it on Amazon. I hope she did an updated copy of it, because some of the languages was a little bit dated on it, but the concept was really the way it is. I mean, you keep on making these different drugs to treat menopausal symptoms.
Is that a bad thing?
Yeah, of course it is. You don't want to treat the. You don't want to treat this. There's three different methods of treating. You can treat lab numbers, right? If somebody comes in, they have these lab numbers. Oh, your thyroid is messed up. I got to give you some. And you get the lab numbers running, and the lab numbers look beautiful, but the person still has thyroid symptoms. What are you doing? You're keeping the lab numbers fine, but it's not helping with the person's symptoms. Well, you can treat the symptoms that somebody has. That's symptom chasing. And then how does that show up? We have different specialists, right? You have a gastroenterologist that's going to give you medication for your gastro stuff, and you're going to go see your endocrinologist that's going to give you medication for your hormonal stuff, and you're going to go to a neurologist that's going to give you medication for your numbness and tingling in your hands, and you're going to go see a rheumatologist to take care of the eggs. You get the idea that everybody's just looking at different pieces and parts.
Right.
So are you going to treat the symptoms that somebody has, or are you going to take into consideration the whole person that's presenting in front of you and kind of find a connection between all of these symptoms and signs, so you're not just chasing different things around.
That sounds good.
Yeah, you treat the person that has the problem, not the problem that the person has. Because I know if I get five different people who come in and they all have the same symptom, I know I'm going to have five different ways of looking at how do I help those people. It's not like, okay, you've got back pain, let's throw you on the table and do back pain treatment.
Mm-hmm.
Well, find out why is this person having that problem. They're imbalancing their kidneys or their liver or they have mental emotional stuff that's causing muscle tension to be in their body and affect their spine and their back. Any kind of reason. 40 million women scheduled to go through menopause in the next 20 years. So here's where we get a lot of information, right? A lot of information comes from the pharmaceutical industry, promoting what on TV? Youth. You know, you keep taking these hormones and you're going to stay youthful.
Yes.
It's a marketing concept. The major side effect of the estrogen progesterone-based hormone replacement therapy include breast cancer, heart attacks, strokes, and blood clots. One of the things that they do find that hormone replacement therapy helps is it can help osteoporosis. Osteoporosis, breast cancer, heart attacks, stroke, blood clots, I'll take the osteoporosis.
And there are other things you can do for osteoporosis.
There are, yeah, definitely. One of the things that there's a category of drugs that they use for treating people with osteoporosis, and they're called selective estrogen. Is that receptorcycle thing again? Receptorcycle modulators. They're called SERMs.
And how about the natural ways, like exercise?
Selective estrogen receptor site modulate. Now these are modulate. The main drug is Evista. Is the drug that they use. So what modulators do is they again working on these receptor sites again. They modulate the sensitivity of this receptor site. So if this is the estrogen receptor site out here. And your body wants, and there's way too much estrogen out here in the system. What happens is this one here becomes down-regulated. The sensitivity becomes less, so you don't get, you know, flood the cells with all the estrogen. You don't have enough estrogen out there, then this thing here becomes very sensitive to it. And so the same amount of estrogen that might be in your system is going to be able, you're going to be able to sensitize this and bring it into here where it's needed. Okay, so it's a modulator. That's what modulators do. So, but this has a bunch of side effects. It's very bad for the liver. So I use a natural one. I use a natural SERM, a selective estrogen receptor site modulator that I can use with people. That works as good as the Evista. It's been tested against the Evista, and it works as good as the Evista does, and it doesn't have any side effects. Now, that's not the place where I'm going to go with everybody that has osteoporosis. The first thing you said was, you know, how about exercise? Yeah, weight-bearing exercise is the best trick you can do for osteoporosis. You know, you get on those, you know, the machines, and you, you know, you do the pump, you know, you press the plates, and, you know, those are, that's a really walking, walking all by itself. You know, doing squats, practicing squats. Yeah, lifting weights, weight training is a really good treatment for osteoporosis. Now, you have to do it slowly at first, right? Because your bones are not dense, and you don't want to hurt yourself. So you start everything slowly, and you, as you get stronger, you build up more weight. Because as you build more weight, as you do, you know what happens when the astronauts go up into outer space? When they come back, they all have osteoporosis. Because you're in outer space, right? Your body in its infinite wisdom says, I don't need all this bone up here. I'm floating around.
You know? Because you're weightless.
You're weightless, right? You don't need, you don't have gravity acting on you to make you have the bone density that you're required to have under 15 pounds per square inch that we have on the surface of the earth. That's the pressure that we're, you know, we're exerting on our structure, 15 pounds per square inch. When you went out of space, you don't have that same pressure. So your body starts dumping bone, dumping calcium. You start to get rid of it. So when they come back from outer space, they have to be very careful. And they get into a slow regimen of building their bones back up again by doing resistance training, weight training. But they have to be careful at first, because their bones are going to be much more brittle when they come back.
So it's not an all is lost situation. If your bones are brittle, you can build them up. It's not a, you know, a death sentence or anything.
She's 68 years old.
She's a fabulous example.
And she just won a third place in a competition last Saturday.
Oh, that's great.
You can go to Port St. Lucie this Saturday. She's going to do a competition down there.
Oh.
At the Civic Center there. Community Center. The government center, what is it called?
Yeah, it's there on the east side of the road. I don't remember what the name of it is. And she didn't start until she was 59, you said.
Right, right.
Wow.
So, this is kind of scary, isn't it? 40 to 80% of hysterectomies are unnecessary. There used to be a doctor right here in Vero Beach. He's not here now, but I didn't say his name anyway, but he was giving women prophylactic hysterectomies and prophylactic mastectomies. Let's just get rid of them so you don't have to worry about it anymore. It's scary, isn't it? There's people that are doing that. Now you get the BRCA test, the BRCA1, BRCA2 test, and it says you have a predisposition to having cancer. And you get a decision to make. You know, when you have a gene though, just because you have a gene doesn't mean that that gene has to express itself. There's a phenomenon called, it's called epigenetics, and it's the interaction of your diet and your lifestyle and your environment in impacting on your genes. And if you're blowing it, if you're having a really lousy lifestyle, then you're going to certainly have a tendency to let those genes express themselves more readily than if you had a, you know, a healthy, happy system. So I'm not saying don't do those things. If you find out that it's there, you have to have peace of mind in your head. But you don't want to do it just because of one lab test that says you've got the BRCA1 too.
Yeah, that's that hint that I was addressing before. Because I've spoken to many other women, and they've kind of got this helmet on that this is the way to do it. This is the way to do it. You think this way.
Yeah.
And you don't have to think that way at all.
You don't. And a lot of it is advertising. It is.
Yes.
So that's what sells in America, youthfulness. For, you're gonna get your information from family and friends too, right? You know, I knew this. I was talking to somebody over the fence the other day, and they were telling me that their cousin's wife was having this problem, and they did this for it, and it really worked out great for them. Okay, does that mean it's gonna work for you? No. And people, you know, do these things and they say these things like, okay, this is gospel. This helped this person. It's gonna help everybody. Nothing out there that's gonna help this everybody with the same condition. You have to individualize what's going on. Now, you might walk out and be one of those people that, you know, tried the thing from the friend, talking to the friend whose cousin's wife tried this thing. And they do it with all the best of intentions, of course, right? But you one of the things you wanna not do is not tell people anything about your health unless they can do something about it, because everybody's going to have an opinion about what you should do about your health, right? Mm-hmm. And we know what opinions are like, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They're like belly buttons. Everybody's got one and they're not good for anything.
And they all stink.
Well, I don't want to go that way. So we already talked a lot about imagine that. Here it is. This is the chart that I wanted to show you guys. Okay. So this is a beautiful chart. You can download this yourself at. I don't know why you would, but some people ask me, where can I get that chart? That's called Harrower's chart, and you can get it at. Still there because he died about a year and a half ago, so I hope they left his website up there. But when you look at this, you want to think of the white here is blood. I mean, okay, so his blood, and we're talking about the ovaries and the testicles here. This is the gonads here, and so your testicles put testosterone into the blood. And the ovaries put estrogen into the blood, and what happens is it goes up to this pituitary here. The pituitary reads it and says, actually it goes all the way to the hypothalamus, but we'll just bring it to here, okay? So it goes to the pituitary, and the pituitary reads it and says, how much you got here? You got too much or you don't have enough? So if you don't have enough estrogen or testosterone coming out of here, then the pituitary is going to make this hormone called follicle stimulating hormone that's going to help women make estrogen, it's going to help men make sperm, and it's going to make luteinizing hormone, abbreviated LH, luteinizing hormone, which is going to make men make testosterone and help women to make progesterone. So you got this feedback mechanism. One of the definitions of menopause is that you haven't had a period for a year, and the FSH, the follicle stimulating hormone, is elevated. Now, why would it be elevated? Because you don't have enough estrogen coming out of here. This is a natural process. You don't have enough estrogen coming out of here. So your pituitary doesn't know that the ovaries aren't working right. All it knows is that, I'm not getting enough estrogen here. So it still sends a signal down to the ovaries to say, make some estrogen. So when you're not making enough estrogen, then your FSH, the signal from here, is going to be elevated. So that's the definition of menopause. FSH is elevated, you haven't had a period for a year. And for guys, your testosterone gets made from here, and the one that controls it up here is luteinizing hormone. Same deal. You don't have enough testosterone coming out of here, then this one here is going to jack up the LH. Your LH is going to be elevated if you don't have enough testosterone coming out of here. So, let's look at a couple of scenarios here. So, not enough estrogen coming out of here. And the pituitary normal reaction we see is that this FSH should be elevated, right? Okay, that's the normal reaction. Or you could have not enough estrogen coming out of here, and you look at the pituitary, the FSH, it's not elevated. So what does that tell us? It tells us that this is not an ovary problem, it's a pituitary problem. Because the pituitary is, you got less coming out of here and not enough stimulus here, then that's a problem here, because this should be jacked up. If the testosterone or estrogen is low, then this should be, the substance coming out of here should be elevated. If it's low, then that's a problem with this guy. Why does that happen? We got adrenal glands here making a connection. So if you, again, comes back to that lifestyle stuff, doesn't it? How many stresses have you had in your life over the course of a prolonged period of time? And too much cortisol coming out of here is going to affect the function of the pituitary, and it's not going to be able to mount a sufficient response to stimulate the ovaries or the testicles to get to work, right? So what's a solution for that? You must meditate, my dear.
Relaxation.
You gotta deal with the stress response, right? Whether that stress response is mental, emotional, or it's physical stress, you know, you're in a wheelchair and you're in pain all the time, and it's gonna be pretty tough to, you know, not be stressed out when you look at yourself in that situation, right? Or you're working in the groves all the time and spraying pesticides and, you know, Roundup all over the place, right? And that affects your system chemicals.
Or the imaginary stuff you make up.
So these are, and the beautiful part about this chart is that when you look at it, you have to realize all these lines are two-way lines. If one of these things is affected, then everything else is going to be affected. Thyroid is a big deal. The major reason why people have menopausal symptoms is because the thyroid isn't working so good. Thyroid is a big deal. Here we got this pancreas. What's that deal with? Blood sugar imbalances, right? Comes back there again too, right? And this is the guy that makes all of the antibodies to help you to fight infections. The thymus gland is a major portion of your immune system. When somebody has an overactive immune system, sometimes one of the operations that they do, barbaric operations that they do, is a thymectomy. They take your thymus gland out. Now you don't make antibodies anymore. Scary, isn't it?
Yes.
Thymectomy. There's a connection here with, look at the ovaries here, testicles, parathyroid connection. That's the guy that helps you get calcium into your tissues. That's the guy that helps to prevent against osteoporosis and keeps your calcium balance, you know, whether you have too much calcium or not enough calcium in your bones. This is the guy that controls that. And that's regulated also by your thyroid gland. And also from adrenal hormones. This is you. This is me. This is us. This is how intricate it is. So you can see that there isn't a one possible solution when somebody has a symptom. You know, you got these symptoms showing up, and the blood work shows this. You could have those numbers in the blood work for so many different kinds of reasons. So you gotta be a detective and kind of put these things together. I love this chart. It's just so helpful. So anything else I need to tell you about that? We already talked about a lot of these things, so I'll kind of go through them. think I need to go through the menstrual cycle for you guys.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, those things you were talking about, the lifestyle things, low blood sugar caused by poor eating habits from overactive pancreas or a toxic liver causes lack of sugar to the brain. The brain runs the show, right? The brain, the nervous system, the immune system, the hormonal system. You have everything working together in the brain to regulate those things. And it can cause emotional symptoms. Experiencing PMS or menopause. Now, here's a very interesting chart. Let me go there first. Okay. So these next three slides here. Symptoms of menopause, PMS. Headaches, backaches. Remember what I said? The symptoms of menopause, are they neurologically based? Are they immune system based? Or are they hormonally based? And you look at these and you say, well, it can't be all hormones. Headaches, backaches, cramps, joint pain, fatigue, water retention, tender breasts, mood swings, increased sugar or chocolate cravings. Those are all PMS symptoms, right? Menopausal symptoms, look at these. It's a lot of the same things, right? One's premenstrual, one is menopausal. Headaches, back pains, hot flashes, mood swings, night sweats, poor libido, irregular bleeding, vaginal dryness, trouble sleeping. And look at these. Symptoms of low blood sugar. Headaches, fatigue, muscle pain, trouble sleeping, night sweats, irritability. So a woman, 51 years old, comes in and she's complaining about hot sweats and irritability, and she's given estrogen.
How do you find out the blood test?
Well,
which
yeah,
one it is?
Yeah, that's the point. You know, a lot of times those blood tests aren't even run. You know, you have these symptoms. You're 51 years old. You've been starting to miss your period. You're going into menopause, so we'll just give you some estrogen. They might have low blood sugar.
Yeah.
You know, and if they can get their diet better. A lot of times those symptoms will go away all by itself. I can't tell you how many times that I've seen people get off of something like grains and a lot of their menopausal symptoms go away. There was a good slide here. Here's another place where we get messed up in our balance of hormones, isn't it?
Yes.
Right? They pump these animals up with all kinds of hormones. Make them grow faster. And we get those hormones. Soy, you gotta watch out for soy. You guys don't, maybe you don't have to worry about it so much, but I know I had a 9-year-old girl come to see me one time, and her mom was, she had all kinds of allergies. Had been allergic to her mother's milk, mom couldn't nurse her. And so mom put her on soy milk for, you know, since she was a baby. And she continued having soy. She was 9 years old. She came fully developed breasts. Nine years old. So, you think about it, this 9-year-old kid is going to be getting hit on by all these 14, 15-year-old boys now, right?
She's not emotionally equipped.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, but the point is that the estrogenic effects of soy can be too much for people. Again, remember the chart. This is, it's the interrelationship of everything that has to be taken into consideration. It's not estrogen is bad, estrogen is good, testosterone is bad, testosterone is good. Where is it in the balance of everything? One of the ways that I like to test people's hormones is I like to use a saliva test to test the hormones, because when any gland makes a hormone, that hormone becomes bound to a protein. Now, the protein is like a taxi cab. So the protein takes the hormone where it's going to get to, any place on that chart there, it's going to take it to where it's supposed to get to, and then the bond gets broken. Now you get the free hormone. The protein just, you know, goes off on its way, picks up another passenger. And so, now this free hormone is the only one that's usable. And it's in the balanced state, it's not usable. When they test you for hormones in your blood, unless they specifically ask for it, and they don't usually, they're going to be testing this hormone here, protein bound. And if you're using a cream, the interesting thing about using a cream is a cream gets directly into your bloodstream, whether it's vaginally or you put it on your shoulder or wherever. It gets directly into your bloodstream, and it doesn't get bound to a protein. So if you do a blood test, it's testing this kind of hormone, the protein-bound hormone, and you're using a cream, you're not going to be measuring what it is that you're taking. Now that's whether it's a pharmaceutical estrogen hormone or a testosterone cream, either one. A lot of people get on the health food store and buy a progesterone cream, and they put the progesterone cream on. And then they get their blood tested, and they test it for protein-bound hormones. And I see it all the time. People come in, and they have their blood tests, and the blood test looks fine. And I do a saliva test or a test for the free hormone, and it's through the roof. It's off the charts. You know, the chart might only go up to 1,000, and it says more than 1,000. That could be 5,000, it could be 10,000, but it's higher than the chart will measure. Now, you can measure the free hormone in your blood, but it's much more expensive. So most doctors measure protein-bound hormones. So the delivery system that you're using, if you're using hormones, makes a difference. And how you measure it makes a difference. I like using the saliva test because it's cheap, and it only measures the free hormone. It doesn't measure the protein-bound hormones. So that's why I like this, because it's going to be usable. And the lab I use also measures the... It measures the luteinizing hormone, it measures the follicle stimulating hormone, it measures these hormones that come out of here. And most of the time, when a lab test that I've seen from various medical offices right here in Vero Beach, I don't see it very often that they checked up with this here. So you have to have that, because you've got to know whether your primary problem is here or it's here. Or it's here. Or it's here. See the connection here with the thyroid and the ovaries and the testicles? There's a major connection between those guys. So everything's going to be working properly. Okay. So the protein. One of the other nice things that I like about Diagnostics, which is the lab that I use there, out in Kent, Washington. Very innovative lab. They do a lot of tests that other labs don't do. But they're a standard lab. Regular medical offices. This is not out there alternative medicine stuff. But one of the things that they measure is a breast proliferation index, and they also measure a uterine proliferation index. So, like I said before, estrogen is proliferative for uterine and breast cancer, and the testosterone is protective for the breast, and the progesterone is protective for the uterus. Well, they give you an index that says, you're androgen dominant, you have too many male hormones, or you're right in the happy box there, and you got just enough estrogen and just enough testosterone to protect the breast, and the happy box over here, you got just enough estrogen and progesterone to protect the uterus. And you could be in one of the other boxes that says that you have a tendency to proliferation of these organs. It's a beautiful thing because you can look at these things and do something about it. And there are natural things that you can use when the hormones are, when you have too much hormone in your system, the hormones get cleared out through the liver. Let's see. You go along here, there's another chart here. There's another slide in here. I want to show you this stuff. I saw this at a doctor's office, and I said, "You got to give me a copy of that." And So I loved it because why? Because it points up the diversity of symptoms, and which is what I've been saying, is it's not always a hormonal issue. It can be neurological in basis. It can be hormonally based, or it can be immune system based.
It all makes sense except for itchy.
Itchy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, people get all kinds of symptoms.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And that can happen to you at any time of your life, not just during menopause.
Yeah.
Anything.
I know. Because you got a brain most of your life, right?
That's right. You know, hopefully.
So here's kind of the progression of what happens. Okay, so your gland makes a hormone, and this arrow here is that protein that I was talking about, the taxicab. And so you get this hormone transport, and then the hormone gets to where it's supposed to get to, you know, like on the chart, you know, somebody's saying, hey, I need some testosterone here. Can you send some estrogen over here? And so, you know, your glands respond. Remember the intricacy of that chart with all the interconnecting lines? So everybody's saying, hey, send me some of this. Hey, you want some of this over here? I'll send it to you. That's kind of the way it is. You get what you need from the organ that produces it, and you do what you needed to do with it, and now it's time to get rid of that hormone. Once you make them, they don't just float around in the blood. You use it, and then you get rid of it. And if you need some more later, you'll make some more. But these hormones, once they get produced, they don't just flow around your blood. If they do, then you're going to be an estrogen-dominant person. Estrogen dominant is not a happy place to be either. So it gets to where it's supposed to get to, and then go through the detoxification process. This is what I was talking about. This is what this stuff all takes place in the liver. So if I get a lab test back and it says somebody's got way too much testosterone in this system, they got way too much progesterone in this system, they got way too much estrogen in this system, I know one of the things that I need to do is I need to give the liver some extra support to be able to clear those hormones up, because that's the organ that clears out the excess hormones. And I see it all the time when people are, when they're taking hormone replacement therapy and they're off the roof, they're off the chart with their levels of their hormones, and nothing is going to work right as long as your hormones are out of balance like that. So I'll do some liver support and then do the test maybe a couple of months later, 6 weeks later, do the test again and see where you are, where you're at. Because you've got to get things level first before you can start adjusting some of the underlying reasons why it got that way in the first place. And then they recycle, you know, they recycle and they go through this whole thing here like that. So some of the problems we talked about, reasons why, weak adrenal glands, improper diet, stress, deficiency of estrogen, progesterone, or both, and then find out why are you having the deficiency of it. The hormone replacement therapy, they often recommend potentially cancer-causing hormone replacement therapy. The Women's Health Initiative was a study that was done. They planned on having this study for 10 years. And the main medication that they gave women was Premarin and Provera. Provera is a synthetically made progesterone. They stopped the study after 3 years because too many women were dying. They stopped. It was a 10-year study that they quit after 3 years. And so the recommendations to this day are, if you're going to go on hormone replacement therapy, take the least effective dose for the shortest amount of time. And I've had women that were on Premarin for 20 years. Mm-hmm. I had a woman in her 70s who was still having periods. Was on Premarin.
I heard women in their 70s still have hot flashes.
Yeah, because they haven't addressed the underlying reasons
why.
You see what I mean? Their adrenal glands are probably shot. so you gotta do things to help.
It's kind of scary.
It is, but that's not the usual case.
Okay.
The usual case is that women, you know, 10, 15 years after menopause, they're usually just fine. How many more years you got left?
I passed the 15 already.
So one of the tests that I always do, whether it's a man or a woman, for andropause or menopause, I do the saliva test for hormones, but I also do an adrenal test, and that's also a saliva test. And that gives you which one of seven different stages of adrenal exhaustion you could possibly be in. And depending on what stage you're in, it's kind of a different way to handle it. So you got to find that information out. This is kind of scary, isn't it? Showed that for every year a woman used the estrogen-only therapy, the risk for breast cancer rose 1%. Each year a woman used the progestin-estrogen combination, her risk went up by 8% for breast cancer. 8%. What does that mean? That means that in 12 years you're at 100% risk of getting breast cancer, right? That's scary. If it's 8% a year, 8 times 12 is almost 100. Okay, and this is what we're talking about here. Now, people say, well, I'm taking bioidentical. Okay, that's better than taking the synthetic one. But again, you want to try and address the underlying reasons. It's not like, okay, I did my blood test and I have low estrogen, I have low testosterone, I'm going to take estrogen or progesterone or testosterone. Find out why. You may in fact have testicles or ovaries that are just not going to make the estrogen or the testosterone anymore because the pituitary is saying, yep, I'm pumping out plenty here. I got, you know, you're low down here, but I'm making sufficient, so it's not a pituitary problem. And so why else might that be? There are instances where people actually have an autoimmune attack on testosterone itself, or even estrogen itself, or the Sirolli cells of the testicles, or the theca cells of the ovary. Sometimes those particular tissues can be attacked by the immune system. And there are tests that you can do for that too. I don't see that too often, but it does happen. And if it is, if that's what's happening, then what? Well, then you got an immune system problem. You don't have a testicle problem or an ovary problem. You have an immune system problem that's attacking that particular tissue. You know, to come to the autoimmune workshop for that information. Actually, it's on my website. Okay. Polycystic ovary disease is there's three things that happen when people have polycystic ovarian syndrome. PCOS is called. PCOS, polycystic ovarian syndrome. They'll have cysts on their ovaries, okay, polycystic ovaries. They'll have elevated testosterone, and they'll have insulin resistance. So that kind of comes back to that whole thing that I was mentioning before, that if a woman is in insulin resistance, she'll have a tendency to start converting her estrogen into testosterone. And then you get cysts on the ovaries too, and you start getting this. So the solution for that, before you can do anything, you got to get the blood sugar in balance, right? You got to get rid of the insulin resistance so you stop converting estrogen into testosterone. Or if you're a guy, you got to get your insulin resistance under control. Otherwise, you're not going to stop converting your testosterone into estrogen. Go to the beach, you'll see guys out there that need a bra, right? and that's what's going on. It's that aromatizing that we're talking about, that we're converting our testosterone into estrogens. to that. So you want to try and, you know, try and get meat. If you're a meat eater or a dairy eater, you want to try and get it at least, I don't know, organic dairy is kind of an oxymoron. I mean, they still pasteurize it, but at least you're not going to get the hormones. Mm-hmm. So if you're going to have dairy, the best dairy you can get is from farm-raised cows, and then you go to the farmer and you have them get you the milk, and it's not pasteurized. That'll be the best. But that's not readily available, so it's just so you're not getting the hormones, at least. If you're going to get dairy, then get the stuff that's organic, because there's not going to be any hormones in it or antibiotics. And you can get free-range, no hormone, no antibiotic, no nitrates, no nitrates stuff right here in the Publix. It's in there. So this one's talking about progesterone cream that we mentioned. Okay, you got to be careful with progesterone cream. You start using progesterone cream and you're not testing it properly, testing for the free hormone, remember, not the protein-bound hormone. If you're using a cream, it gets directly into your system. If you're using injections, it gets directly into your system. It doesn't become bound to a protein. So if you're going to use those delivery systems, then you need to test for the appropriate delivery system. If you're taking pills, those are going to become bound to a protein. So you want to take that. In that case, then you do the blood test. It's going to test for what it is that you're taking. And if you're going to buy stuff in the health food store, you want to see this label on it, USP, United States Pharmacopoeia. And what that says is that what's on the bottle is in the bottle. That's what it's telling you. It's a USP. What's on the bottle, what it says is on the bottle, is actually in the bottle. Otherwise, you go down to the health food store and you buy some ginseng, and you don't know if you're getting ginseng leaf or ginseng twig or ginseng root. The only active part of the ginseng plant that most people buy it for is the root. So they're not lying to you. It's ginseng, but it's not going to do what you want ginseng to do. So USP is important. And there are some natural herbs that you can use. Again, I put these up here to, you know, let you know there are some things that can actually have some hormonal effects, but like I said before, you do what you got to do to make yourself comfortable, but if you got to keep on taking something, whether it's a pharmaceutical or it's Chinese herbs or Western herbs, if you got to keep on taking this stuff in order to keep yourself feeling comfortable, again, it's still not addressing the underlying reasons why. They can be helpful at least to, you know, start off to make yourself comfortable while you work on some of those underlying imbalances, but you don't want to have to depend on anything. We talked about that. Women who suffer from low blood sugar can be misdiagnosed as having hormonal problems. Remember blood sugar? Blood sugar will throw off the hormones, the immune system, or the nervous system. Vitamins and minerals, if they're deficient, that can be a problem too. Calcium, this says calcium and magnesium are essential to prevent and treat osteoporosis, not in menopause. In menopause, osteoporosis is mostly about hormones. You're going to get your daily diet of magnesium and calcium. You also want to make sure you use vitamin D. Vitamin D is a big deal. Fish oil is a big deal. It'll help with osteoporosis. But remember, the best treatment for osteoporosis is going to be weight training. But most usual reason for osteoporosis is more hormonally based in menopause than it is dietary. So the phosphoric acid in soft drinks, that can contribute to depleted calcium levels. Even if it's a diet, it's probably still got phosphoric acid in it. And phosphorus is going to have a leaching effect on the calcium. So you need phosphorus, you need calcium, you need magnesium, you need potassium, you need all these things, but it's about the balance of these things. That's where it's at. You get too much of any of those nutrients, you get too much calcium, you're going to start having muscle spasms, cramping muscles. You know, calcium is the main nutrient that helps us to contract our muscles. Well, if it's too much, then you have a tendency to have muscle contractions. And magnesium does completely the opposite of that. It helps. It makes the muscles more relaxed and it's a natural muscle relaxer. Okay. Anything else up here we need to talk about? Oh, I liked it so much I put it in there. That's a great chair. If I had my way of making this chart over again, I've tried to do it, but it just didn't look the same. I would have loved to have seen the adrenal glands be in the middle here instead of the thyroid. The thyroid's a big deal, it really is. But in this was probably 100 years ago. This chart was made by a guy named Harrower. And 100 years ago, they didn't have the stresses. Well, everybody, we've had stresses forever, okay? Tigers chasing us, whatever. Okay. But we're just inundated with stress. You get stressed out when you turn the TV on?
It's the news, yes. That's right.
Yes. To solve that, we watch CBS in the morning, and it's Your World in 90 Seconds. Mm-hmm. And I watch The World in 90 Seconds, and I'm done. Okay. That's all I need. Flashes 3 months, yeah. So, and so this is in Menopause magazine. Acupuncture all by itself. I mean, before I was doing any of these blood tests or anything, I was still helping people with menopausal symptoms. Just using acupuncture. Homeopathic medicines are really helpful with menopausal symptoms. Cleared menstrual pain, acupuncture is really good. Any kind of pain. If somebody has pain, there isn't anything better than acupuncture for pain. So why would, and we can measure with lab tests, we can measure that you needle a point with an acupuncture needle and you measure the hormones, and the balance of the hormones can change just using acupuncture. Blood chemistry can change by using acupuncture. So we can measure these things. Because it's go ahead.
I want to ask you about homeopathic medicines. I know they work because I've taken them. But how do they work? Are they?
Oh boy.
Yeah.
You're gonna have to take my five week course. 15 hour 5 week course. Yes.
I did. I did, but I don't understand.
Yeah.
The symbiosis between the body and homeopathic medicine.
Because we're energetic beings.
Right, I remember that, the energy.
Okay, so here we are. Well, here's somebody, you're with this person here, and now 2 seconds later they're dead, okay? What's the difference between this state here and this state? In this state, there's no more, they've still got the blood there, the hormones are there, the nerves are there, everything is still there. There's no life force that's making any of those chemical processes happen anymore. That's the level we're talking about with homeopathy and with acupuncture. We're working on the life force. So when I say that we can make hormonal differences and blood chemistry differences with acupuncture, it's not because I'm working on the blood chemistry. We're working to get the energy system that makes all of that stuff work. It's deeper. I mean, 300 years ago, we didn't even know that there was a blood circulatory system until a guy named Harvey discovered the blood circulatory system. Now we know that the blood circulatory, we take it for granted, right? You've got blood vessels and you've got bronchioles and you've got veins and arteries, you know, that, that transport the blood through the system, right? Well, there's also an energy circulatory system that we're finally starting to recognize even in Western medicine. We can measure with modern instruments that there's something happening different electrically at this point than there is over at this point. We can measure it. We can measure that there's acupuncture points that have different electrical conductivity than the its surrounding points. So homeopathy is working with the energetics of a particular substance. It's not the substance, because as we keep on diluting and diluting and diluting and diluting a substance, originally, eventually you reach a point where there's not one molecule left of the original substance. There's only the energy of that original substance. And when you're at that point where there's no more substance left, then your body is still going to recognize the energy of that stuff. But there's not enough physical substance to cause your physiology to have a response. So I'll give you a really good example. You have Ipecac. You know what Ipecac does? Yeah, you take Ipecac because you swallowed some poison or something. You want to make sure you throw up. So you take some syrup of Ipecac, and it'll make you throw up. If you take Ipecac in a homeopathic potency, a diluted potency, it cures nausea and vomiting. It does completely the opposite. Because why? Because there's not enough of that physical dose of the Ipecac to make that physiological reaction happen, throwing up. But the energy of that stuff is still there. And so your body recognizes the energy of that stuff and never wants to throw up. But the dose of the physical Ipecac is going to make you throw up. That's what it does. It's a drug reaction, right? So if your body is recognizing the energy of that and it doesn't want to throw up, then you're going to be, your own body is going to be stimulated to mount a response against the throw up, the vomiting mechanism.
It's miraculous, actually. It
makes more sense when you think of things energetically.
That's like arsenic, you take that within your blood, but if you have too much, it'll kill you.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a beautiful example. There was this one experiment that they used, they used rats. So people die from arsenic poisoning. Why? Because remember arsenic and old lace with the little old ladies?
Yep.
Did you get that movie in Germany?
No.
Okay. So these nice little English women, well, maybe they were from the South, I don't know, but they would invite these people that they didn't like in for tea.
Yep, in for tea.
And they were so sweet and nice, you know.
Sweet.
Yep. And they would invite them in for tea, and they, lace the tea with arsenic. And then, the person would leave and have a fun, nice social evening and come back in the next day and or the day after and have some more tea, and they'd give them some more tea. So arsenic works on your system because you don't excrete it. It's going to get lodged in your tissue, so you'll reach a cumulative point where eventually it's going to reach a dose where it'll kill you. So these people didn't know anything. They were so sweet, you know.
Do you like
a lump of sugar in your tea? And so you didn't have the tea. So anyway, the point is that it accumulates in your body and it reaches a lethal dose and then you die. So what they did is they took these rats and they fed the rats arsenic and measured the stools and the urine and everything, did it all scientifically, and no arsenic in the stools and no arsenic in the urine, and they gave half the rats homeopathic arsenic. And the rats that they gave the homeopathic arsenic to started purging arsenic in their stools and in their urine. So we can use homeopathic remedies to be like a drainage type of therapy sometimes. Yeah. Pretty cool experiment. But that, I don't know when I'm going to teach. I usually teach it in April. I'll have to wait until things slow down a little bit for me.
Yeah.
I like to do it twice a year, but right now I'm kind of backed up a little bit. Okay.
Are you still working on your MD also?
Yeah, I just came from doing my last round in pediatrics. So next week I start gynecology, and then I do 12 weeks of surgery, and I'm done.
Yes.
Okay, that just talks a little bit about the acupuncture education people get. I can tell you, people ask me all the time, you know, how long does it take to learn this stuff? And my usual answer is, so far.
That's right.
It's endless. So the adrenal glands. I already talked, I'm zipping through these because we've already talked about a lot of this stuff, okay? Muscle testing, some of the things that I do, saliva tests, PMS. This is what we're talking about, increasing the life-giving circulation to stuck areas. You bring the life force, the energy to the area that's having a problem, and you get out the way. Body has its own healing wisdom, and sometimes it just gets blocked up. So my job as an acupuncturist is to get the circulation going to the part of the body that's having a problem, and just get out of the way, let the body heal itself. I just send it over. So here's the history of conventional medicine, pretty much, right? 2,500 years ago, Hippocrates. Here's what we got for history in Chinese medicine. 5,000 years ago in Europe, we were pretty much just coming out of the caves, right? I mean, it's the longest lived, continuous civilization that we have on the planet right now, right? Maybe we talk about Atlantis and the other ones, but they're not around right now. 2 billion people worldwide. That's kind of an interesting slide. 2 billion people worldwide, I mean, it's a humongous population. Some of acupuncture came about by trial and error. They had a tremendous amount of information to get from their population with this work. And the Chinese are very practically minded. If something doesn't work, they're just going to get rid of it. Bruce Lee said it perfectly. You know, take what's useful and discard the rest. 12 million Americans, and so we use it for all kinds of. My training in China was people that had had strokes. That was what I concentrated on in China. I saw people getting out of wheelchairs in a couple days, people who couldn't speak, and a couple days later they were reading the newspaper out loud. So if you know people that have strokes, the sooner they get, they gotta have acupuncture. It's a specific form of acupuncture, using scalp acupuncture, because there's nothing that's going to work as dramatically as acupuncture for stroke relief. If somebody's had it for years, then I don't know if I'm going to be able to help them. Fibromyalgia, low back pain. These are all things that any acupuncturist can be able to help.
Yeah. What if you had surgery in the back and
had
titanium pins in your spine?
You're screwed.
You're right. Literally.
Now, let me just say that. It limits some of my options anyway. For people that have chronic back pain, I like to use prolotherapy. Prolotherapy is an injection therapy. It's completely the opposite of steroid injection.
Prolo?
Yeah, Prolo. Go on my website, look at prolotherapy.
Okay.
Under services. But you're not a candidate for it because you got the metal back there.
Okay.
This is kind of the National Institute. When acupuncture first came over to this country back in the early 70s, you know, the FDA didn't want to just launch it on public and not have any kind of an idea of what was going on. So the National Institute for Health did a study to find out what are the side effects of acupuncture. So they did this study. The they found was that acupuncture causes unexplained euphoria. So, watch out for that. They'll make it illegal. So it's a natural life event, and you want to treat it like that, not as a disease process. So the gift is the opportunity to come down and sit and talk. If you got blood work, please bring it with you, because it's going to give me some information that I can give back to you. If you bring down your blood work, I'll go over it with you. I can tell you that I'll give you a reading on your blood work that nobody ever gave you. And I'll give you a written report with it that gives you the reasons why. If something is elevated or it's low, I'll give you reasons why it's elevated or it's low. And we can kind of look at, so it's even like that when you're looking at blood work. It's not like one marker means the same thing all the time. You've got elevated cholesterol and you're putting something over your cholesterol. You gotta look at reasons why. So I'll just run it out quick. Some of the reasons that people have elevated cholesterol, just an example. The first reason is insulin resistance or diabetes. And I want you to hear at the end of the list what's missing, why people have elevated cholesterol, okay? Insulin resistance, diabetes, low thyroid, diet high in refined carbohydrates, pancreatic dysfunction, hepatobiliary dysfunction, renal dysfunction, family history, pregnancy, or steroids. Those are the reasons why people have elevated cholesterol. So you look at the rest of the panel and you see, okay, well, I got this elevated cholesterol, so with some of the liver markers here. Is that a factor? Okay, no, okay, well, maybe, how about my blood sugar? My blood sugar out of balance. Is that a reason why? Have I been taking steroids for painkillers or am I taking whatever? You look through the rest of the panel and you kind of try and cross off if it doesn't make any sense, and you look and see what you're left over with, and then you can kind of make a determination on what's the crux of the issue that this person has. So that's what the gift is. You want to come down, you want to talk about your stuff. You don't have to blab it to everybody here. I'll be happy to sit with you and talk about those things, okay?
You're the detective.
Huh?
Yeah, you're the detective.
Yes.
Oh, you're gonna die when I tell you this. But for 10 years before I was an acupuncturist, I was a private investigator.
It's natural.
Yeah.
It is natural. He doesn't work. He just loves what he
does. Yes.
Gotta move my back or my
seat. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.